Okay, welcome back. We are discussing a variety of topics in Unit 5. The topic for this lecture is compact models. Now, way back in Unit 1, I said a little bit about compact models. I'd just like to return to compact models and say a little bit more. This is an important topic. You should know a little bit about compact models. If you work in semiconductor technology, you'll want to learn a lot about compact models. We really could use a course on compact models. All I can do in this lecture is just point out some things that you should be aware of and dive deeper into. So in Unit 1, I mentioned that we can think of two different kinds of compact models. The models that we have been focusing on in this course I referred to as compact physical models. So these are models, simple analytical models. The models that we have been developing are virtual source model that capture the essential physics. They sort of summarize our conceptual understanding of the physical operation of the device. They can be useful in analyzing experiments, as we discussed in the previous unit, extracting physically meaningful parameters like transmission, mean free paths, series resistances, things like that. They can be useful in monitoring processes, so they have a variety of important uses. This is the kind of model that we have been discussing in this course. That's where our focus has been. But there's another kind of compact model, as I mentioned in Unit 1. These I referred to as compact models for circuit simulations. So these are models that accurately describe the electrical performance of a device across a wide range of temperatures, biases, layout geometries. They do so in a form that is suitable for use in numerical circuit simulation program so that designers can use these models to design complex electronic circuits. Now, the model does not need to be physical. It could be a set of empirical parameters that fits the measured characteristics of the device very well. But we generally prefer the core of the model to be a physical model. And I'll explain why in just a minute. So these kinds of models are extremely important because they interface semiconductor technology to circuit design. Now, in terms of the second type of model, the compact model for circuit simulation, there are two broad classes that you'll hear people talking about. There's a table-based approach, and a table-based approach takes constructs large tables of either measured electrical data or simulated data, and interpolates from that table to describe the electrical performance of the device smoothly. Okay. A second type of model is the physics-based model. So this is a set of analytical or maybe very simple numerical expressions that describe a device across a wide range of biases, a range of different layout geometries that designers might use, a range of temperatures that might be encountered. Now, generally, there's a role for each of these. The table-based models are quick to develop. If you're exploring early technology and you can get some data or you can simulate a new device, for example, you can quickly produce a model and start looking at the impact of this device on applications. But it's generally preferred, if we're going to use a model for serious design, that it be physics-based. Why is that? Well, there are a number of reasons. One is that it relates the needs of the designers in terms of circuit performance to the manufacturing process. So we can go to the manufacturing process and we could say we could use a thinner gate insulator. We need to have lower series resistance. The parameters in the model are not just curve fitting parameters, they have physical significance. You can talk to a semiconductor technologist and work on those and improve the performance of the circuit. Generally, these types of models result in the fewest number of parameters, and that simplifies the calibration procedure. When you're going to calibrate the models and tweak them to accurately describe a given manufacturing process, it's easier if there are a relatively small number of very physical parameters. They also provide the best basis for statistical and mismatch modeling of devices. For example, your manufacturing process might know that the gate oxide thickness is controlled to plus or minus X percent. Then you can directly relate those numbers into the performance of a circuit. And as manufacturing processes evolve, Maybe some thicknesses of layers, some doping densities, some channel lengths change during the course of the manufacturing process. Since these are physical parameters, it's relatively easy to go back in the model and quickly adapt it to the new manufacturing process, and you're in business again. The major drawback of these models is that it's very time-consuming and a long-involved process in order to develop very good models of this kind. But they're generally the preferred model if you have a mature, you know, important high-volume application that you're working on. Now, we've discussed this MIT version of the virtual source model as we've gone throughout this course and made it more and more sophisticated. There are versions of this model that you can download and use for circuit design, but I wouldn't call it an industry-strength, general-purpose model for digital design because of a number of reasons. One is we have developed this model to describe short-channel devices, but designers may have a need for long-channel devices which behave more like quadratic square-law MOSFETs. We have to be able to smoothly, the model needs to be able to smoothly go from a short-channel to a long channel, anywhere in between. The MVS model doesn't do that. It doesn't treat a number of second and third order effects. And for example, it doesn't treat things like noise, which are very important to designers. It doesn't treat the layout dependencies, the particular geometry of the layout of the gate and the transistors. And these are all very important to designers. There are a number of other things. Now, you could go back and spend some time and work and develop this into an industry strength industrial model. But that is a long involved process. And there are good industry strength models, so you want to be very careful about doing that. It's very difficult for a company that is committed to one particular model and has calibrated their manufacturing process and is using that for a long period of time to switch to another model, even if it turns out to be better. It's done, but it's done infrequently, only when it's important. Now, one of the other limitations of our virtual source model is that it's focused on the source. We focused on the source for physical reasons. That allowed us to understand very simply how these small MOSFETs operate. But there are issues. The quadratic square law model of the MOSFET that was developed in the 1960s, this is also a source referenced model. We talk about the VGS. Everything depends on whether VGS is greater than VT, V gate to source. But problems occur when VDS changes sign. A MOSFET, most MOSFETs are symmetrical devices. The terminal with the more positive voltage is the drain, the other terminal is the source. But during circuit operation, the voltages might switch. And at some times, one terminal might be acting as a drain and sometimes the other. So it is really best not to formulate models for circuit design as source referenced models, because then problems occur when you go through the origin and VDS switches sign. Now, it can be done. In fact, there's a reference here of a very early model that shows one way of doing a model that is not referenced to the source. But this is, you know, over the years, people have learned that one needs to be very careful about this, or artifacts are introduced into the model as you sweep through VDS equals zero and you go from positive to negative terms. So the compact modeling community has developed a number of tests. This is one of those tests. If you have a model that's been developed, you can run it through some of these tests and see whether it's going to have problems that might create issues for circuit designers. One is called the Gummel symmetry test. This particular test, you set it up so that we sweep a voltage Vx, which is attached to both of the terminals, plus Vx to one, minus Vx to the other. We then sweep Vx from minus the power supply voltage divided by two to plus the power supply voltage divided by two. We fix the gate voltage, not the gate to source voltage, we fix the gate voltage referenced to ground. And we sweep Vx, and as we do that, the drain to source voltage is always twice Vx. So the drain to source voltage will go from plus VDD to minus VDD. And while we're doing that, we can monitor the current and the slope of the current, etc. So if you do that, you know, qualitatively, you should get characteristics that sort of look like this from your model. And what was discovered is many models had problems right around the origin, and they didn't behave the way they were supposed to behave. This introduced problems, especially in issues like small signal parameters and distortion of analog circuits and things like that. So designers need these kinds of robust, very well behaved models for high volume or high importance application designs. But the simpler models, even if they have some of these issues, can still be very useful for early stage R&D and exploring the implications of a new device on technology, for example. Now, let me just say a word about device research in general. I've been fortunate in my career to sort of have it occur during the golden age of device research. This is a quote by Herbert Kroemer, a very famous semiconductor scientist who won a Nobel Prize for his semiconductor work in 2001. And this is from his Nobel lecture. So Herb made the point that the application of any sufficiently novel device applications will arise to make use of novel new devices. You invent a device, we'll find an application for it. That was a very good philosophy for a long time. But electronics is much more mature today. You know, there is still some of this, and we still want to look for these possibilities. But there are many devices available, many materials available. Semiconductor technology is very sophisticated. More and more we're driven today by what is the impact of this new device on applications. How can it outperform? How can it do something that can't be done today? So there is more and more need for device researchers to be thinking about applications at an early stage. What are the implications of my new device on applications that could be important or that people care about? And for this reason, device and material scientists should learn something about compact models and be able to use them to sort of explore the impact of their new device or their new material on applications, even at an early stage of research. Okay, so you're looking for a compact model. Where do you find a compact model? Unfortunately, there is no single repository where you can go and find all of the compact models that have been developed, either open source or the ones that need to be licensed. There are a couple of places that you can look. One is the NEEDS website. There are almost 50 compact models, open source compact models that researchers from across the world have submitted to that repository. You might be able to find one that suits your purposes. Maybe you find one that's close that you can modify. So that might be a good place to begin. Now, the designers need a robust industrial strength models. There is a coalition of companies that has been formed to support the development and ongoing support of these kinds of models. It's called the Compact Model Coalition. They have a variety of models that many companies rely on that are continuously maintained and supported. And if you're a member of that coalition, you can obtain access to those models. I also want to make you aware of one of the important industry strength MOSFET models is called BISM. This is the Berkeley short channel IGFET model. IGFET is insulated gate field effect transistor. It's what we used to call MOSFETs. This was developed in 1987, the first version. It's undergone many versions. Many of the initial problems with compact models have been discovered and taken care of in this. It is widely used by many companies. Virtually all circuit simulation programs now will have the BISM model built into it. So if you're working on MOSFETs, it's a model that you want to be familiar with and very well may be using. Okay, as I said, almost any commercial circuit simulation program that you encounter will have the BISM model as one of its options. Well, what if you don't have a model? What if you have a brand new device and you have to write your own model? Well, there is a language for doing so. It's called Verilog A. Verilog A was actually an industry standard model for modeling analog systems, basically at a functional level, but it's been extended so that it is now a language for writing compact models. It can be used by probably all commercial simulators will take a Verilog A script and will compile it into source code and run it at native speed within the circuit simulation program. Some open source simulators do that too. If you're interested in learning about Verilog A, I've got a couple of pointers to additional information here. There is also an open source MATLAB-based program that is designed to be an environment for writing and experimentally validating the functionality and suitability of a compact model, running simple circuits so that you can test its applications in circuits. It can even be in those models then can even be inserted in some open source SPICE engines. It's also as a useful first step for people who are new to Verilog A modeling, but are familiar with MATLAB. It's a good way to write a model, get it working, find the issues, test and debug it before you write your Verilog A model. And the Verilog A model then may be more usable in commercial circuit simulators, at least at this time. So you can find additional information on MAP, this MATLAB-based environment, at this website. Now, before you write the compact model, you really should take some time to familiarize yourself with the many lessons that have been learned in the issues in compact models that can pop up, all of the things that have been discovered over the years in making MOSFET models better and better and more robust. Many of those lessons learned can be applied to novel devices as well, and you should try to acquaint yourself with some of those lessons. A good place to begin is by doing a search for Colin McAndrew, who has been one of the leaders in this field. All right, so this is just a quick lecture on some topics in compact modeling that I wanted to sensitize you to and to encourage you to learn more about if you continue to work in semiconductor technology. So a couple of key points. Compact models link semiconductor technology to manufacturing and circuit design. They really play a very important role. Now, compact models can also be used, and more they're being used, to link earlier stage research and development to the design and applications that they may impact. So if you're going to develop a compact model, you need a good understanding of the physics of this new device that you're working on, because we prefer the models to be as physics-based as possible. But you also need to understand what goes on inside a circuit simulator, how this complicated system of nonlinear equations is solved, because your model must behave robustly under those numerical algorithms and in that environment. And very importantly, you also must understand the applications that this device might be put to, because those applications will determine which characteristics of the device are the most important ones to focus on and to get most accurate as you develop a model. And finally, many of the lessons learned, and there have been many over the years in developing circuit models for MOSFETs, are more broadly applicable to devices of any kind, and you should acquaint yourself with some of those lessons learned so that you don't have to go through the pain of learning them for the first time yourself. You can deal with the new issues that are specific to your particular device. All right, so that's a little bit about compact models. We've covered a lot of different topics in Unit 5. What I'd like to do in the next lecture is just to quickly review some of the main points of Unit 5, and then we'll be wrapping up the course.